Harper Audio presents A Girl's Guide to Joining the Resistance, A Feminist Handbook on Fighting for Good, by Emma Gray, read by Andi Arndt. Introduction. On the evening of November 22, 1909, several thousand garment workers squeezed into Cooper Union's Great Hall in New York City. The crowd was almost all women, many still in their teens. They were there to discuss the poor working conditions that plagued their industry. Low wages, inhumane hours, abusive and unsafe environments, and whether they should call for a general strike among shirtwaist makers. This meeting was the culmination of a series of smaller strikes organized by female labor activists, several of which had led to arrests and violence against the picketing workers. The speakers slated for that evening included labor leaders such as the American Federation of Labor's Samuel Gompers, the Women's Trade Union League's Leonora O'Reilly, and B. Feigenbaum of the Jewish Daily Forward. One after another, they expressed solidarity with the shirtwaist makers, talking at length about the terrible conditions the workers experienced, while failing to offer concrete actions. Eventually, a slight 23-year-old Ukrainian Jewish woman named Clara Lemlich, erroneously described by reporters as a teenager, despite already being an experienced organizer, could stand it no longer. "I want to say a few words," she yelled out, before delivering a short, powerful speech in Yiddish. "I have listened to all the speakers. I would not have further patience for talk, as I am one of those who feels and suffers from the things pictured. I move that we go on a general strike." And they did. The next morning, 15,000 shirtwaist makers went on strike. By night, that number had grown to 20,000. Some estimate that as many as 40,000 shirtwaist makers eventually joined the movement. This strike, known alternately as the Uprising of the 20,000 and, my personal favorite, the Revolt of the Girls, gave energy to the organizing efforts of women garment workers across the country. Within the year, thousands of women workers had gone on strike, from Philadelphia to Chicago. The 11-week-long Uprising of the 20,000 didn't get the strikers all of their demands, but it did result in concrete progress. 339 waist and dress manufacturers signed contracts granting shorter work weeks, paid holidays, wage negotiations, and a promise not to discriminate against unionized workers. In 1954, Lemlich, who remained an activist throughout her life, gave an interview about her early days as a labor organizer. "What did I know about trade unionism?" she said. "Audacity. That was all I had. Audacity." The 2016 presidential election felt, in some ways, like a referendum on the value of women and people of color and immigrants and refugees and Muslims. The list goes on. One that we had lost. On the evening of November 9th, I walked in a daze under the gray, drizzly haze that seemed to permeate New York City to meet three friends, all women who shared my single-minded desire to sit in a cozy, dark corner and plot the resistance. Or at the very least, feel a modicum of usefulness. En route to the meetup, I passed Cooper Union, which stands just around the corner from my office, the site of Clara Lemlich's speech, the place where she had refused to be silent and allow inaction 107 years before. In the months following the presidential election, I found myself thinking a lot about women like Clara. Women who had the audacity to speak out and organize for change before it was possible to rally the masses with a viral hashtag or even cast a vote at the ballot box. American history is filled with women who slowly but surely transformed the country. But since men's stories are the ones that tend to dominate our history books, we hear less about the contributions of these extraordinary women. Women such as civil rights leader Diane Nash, who co-founded the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, SNCC, and was instrumental in organizing sit-ins and freedom rides to protest segregation in the South. Or Sarah and Angelina Grimke, white Quaker sisters and abolitionists, who were the first women to testify on the issue of Black American rights before a state legislature. They spent much of their lives speaking publicly against slavery, even debating men, something that was nearly unheard of at the time. or Sylvia Rivera, who at the age of 17 was one of the drag queens who fought back against police when they came to raid the Stonewall Inn, helping start the seminal 1969 Stonewall riots. According to the New York Times, as the riot began, Sylvia yelled, "I'm not missing a minute of this. It's the revolution." Or human rights and anti-racism activist and author Grace Lee Boggs, the daughter of Chinese immigrants, who grew up to adopt the teachings of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and hosted Malcolm X at her Detroit home. As OG feminist icon Gloria Steinem once said, "Power can be taken, but not given. The process of the taking is empowerment in itself." Each one of these trailblazing women took power where none was bestowed. Today, women are getting to watch that process of the taking play out right in front of their eyes, necessitated by a political moment that is distinctly hostile to women's rights. Women are leading the resistance, from the courts to the streets to Hollywood to the halls of Congress. Senators such as Kamala Harris, Elizabeth Warren, and Kirsten Gillibrand are persisting like the nasty women they are. Alicia Garza, Opal Tometi, and Patrice Cullors, the women behind Black Lives Matter, are channeling their movement's energy into combating an administration's open disdain for Black and Brown lives. Women's March national co-chairs Carmen Perez, Tamika Mallory, Linda Sarsour, and Bob Bland are turning the massive energy the world witnessed on January 21, 2017, into a movement with true staying power. And it's not just the most visible leaders of this resistance that matter. Not only has progressive activism surged overall since November 2016, but women are more likely than their male counterparts to write and call Congress, march and protest, and express an intention to get more involved in the coming years. American women of all ages are showing up and doing the work and giving a fuck. This book is for the women and girls who give all the fucks, because there have always been women and girls who did. Women and girls who showed up to fight for their own inalienable rights and the rights of others. This book is for every woman who has chosen to give a fuck despite the odds being stacked against her. I learned so much from listening to the women I spoke to while writing this book. I hope these pages can serve as a beginner's guide to getting involved, or at least a crash refresher course. Writing it certainly was for me. You'll learn steps you can take to start making a tangible difference and how to stay, at least relatively, sane while doing it. And you'll get all this advice from women who live and breathe what they are talking about every damn day, women who have the audacity today that Clara Lemlich had in 1909. In April 1912, Clara Lemlich argued passionately for working women's right to the vote. "We are here, and we are here to stay," she said. Today, we are here, and we are here to stay. So, dear reader, go forth and change the world. There's an army of women who came before you, and they all have your back. Part 1. Welcome to the Resistance. Chapter 1. There's no time like the present to give all the fucks. If not now, when? Hillel the Elder. When I asked Black Lives Matter co-founder Alicia Garza what would happen if Americans didn't wake up and get active, she didn't mince words. If we don't collectively get active in defense of safety and justice for all of us, a lot of us will reap the consequences, including death, she said. No one is coming to save us except for us, so we might as well get to work. That's a sentiment I heard echoed by many of the activists I spoke to for this book. The time for action is now. Yesterday, really. And if you are a person who cares about your own future, the future of the people around you, and the future of your nation, it's your responsibility to roll up your metaphorical sleeves and jump into the fray. Of course, this can be easier said than done. It's scary and overwhelming to think about how much is at stake. Access to healthcare, abortion rights, voting rights, the physical safety of trans people when they walk down the street, the physical safety of Black Americans when they interact with police, and, you know, the survival of the entire freaking earth. The first months of Donald Trump's presidency provided a litany of examples of what can happen when a white supremacist agenda makes its way into the White House. The following are just a handful. Travel bans targeting Muslim-majority countries were issued. The GOP attempted to do some combination of repealing and replacing the Affordable Care Act, which left up to 32 million people vulnerable to losing health insurance over less than 10 years. The president pulled back protections for women workers. The president touted what he labeled a military operation to identify, arrest, and deport undocumented immigrants. A guidance protecting transgender students in public schools was rescinded. A budget was proposed that cut funding for PBS, the National Endowment for the Arts, and Meals on Wheels. The president pulled the United States out of the Paris Climate Agreement. The global gag rule was drastically expanded, prohibiting any global health funding for organizations that provide or even mention abortion as an option to women. An Obama-era rule that prohibited mentally ill individuals from purchasing guns was rolled back. The president signed a measure that allows states to withhold Title X funding for family planning from clinics that provide abortions. The president issued a memo directing the Pentagon to ban transgender people from openly serving in the U.S. military. Let's play a terrifying game and try to name a few of the groups that stood to be impacted by those decisions: trans kids, undocumented immigrants, documented immigrants, Muslim Americans, public school students, children who watch Sesame Street, poor senior citizens, artists, women who need birth control, women who need maternity care, anyone who needs health care at some point in their lives and can't afford to pay thousands of dollars every time they access it, all Americans who would prefer the United States protect its national security interests, people who are looking to spend some quality time on planet Earth. That covers a hell of a lot of people. This is a time to define the values our country stands for and to fight for those values, Tina Chen, former Chief of Staff to First Lady Michelle Obama and Executive Director of the Obama White House Council on Women and Girls, told me. Like caring for those in need, expanding social justice for all, and protecting our planet for future generations. The beauty of our democratic system is that these choices are in the hands of the people, citizens who can make their voices and their votes heard. And during those first months of Trump's presidency, we witnessed what a difference it makes when people are paying attention and taking a stand. The women's marches across the country became the largest single-day demonstration in U.S. history. People showed up en masse to protest at airports within hours of Trump's initial sweeping travel ban. Citizens came to town halls and flooded their elected officials' offices with calls, creating political roadblocks for a GOP-controlled Congress that wanted to swiftly repeal and replace the Affordable Care Act. Thousands of women expressed interest in running for office. Collective action makes a difference. We've seen it happen. When you are a member of a group whose basic rights and safety are generally protected, it can be easy to ignore that the rights and safety of your fellow citizens are not. This cushion of security can make it seem to some of us like politics is something that can be separated from ourselves and our lives. For some Americans, the election was a clarifying moment. For some, specifically middle and upper-class progressive white people, a long-treasured vision of this country as unified and fundamentally open-minded was dashed. It's not that our nation actually transformed overnight, though in some circles it certainly felt like it had. It's more that the fury and resentment and tribalism that had long existed within communities that felt ignored and threatened, helped along by healthy doses of xenophobia, Islamophobia, racism, and sexism, had come bubbling up to the surface and into our country's voting booths. It's far harder to ignore all the underlying inequalities that make up American society when a walking, talking, pussy-grabbing orange caricature of incompetent toxic masculinity is its face. I think a lot of silver spoons were pulled out of mouths, and now people are understanding that they can't take their happiness or their health care or the political process for granted, organizer and writer Raquel Willis told me. Of course, those silver spoons were only in the mouths of people born white and straight and cisgender and financially secure, people like me. The truth is that there were always people fighting, Raquel continued. Thinking about the most marginalized, people of color, black folks, poor folks, disabled folks, trans folks, queer folks, and women. We've been fighting. It's only now that I think people are starting to understand that the reason we haven't been more successful is because we weren't invested in the liberation of those other marginalized folks as much as we should have been.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.